mean, I look back now, thank you for the nice plan, $7 million for a year.
Morning, everybody. Well, if it took a lot for everybody to come in today, it's like I'm kind of dragging a little bit getting in. Seems like the short daylight hours takes a toll on you. But got several announcements kind of scrolling through. If you've had a chance to see that, calendars up to date, things like that, they're kind of coming at us. And it seems like just as I consider the time that it takes, you know, we're in the holiday season, distractions, busyness, all the things coming at you all at once, a flood of memories, and it's a challenge. I know it's tough sometimes. So I want to start with a word of prayer this morning. Lord, we're asking for an outpouring of your Holy Spirit today, that you would fill the void in our lives. We thank you, God, that you came to earth through that of a newborn child, the miraculous delivery and even conception. God, that you came to make a way. You cleared the path. You gave us direction. And Lord, in this world, we face many troubles and difficulties, challenges with health and finance, with relationships, all the different things, Lord, that you've arranged that for us for eternity, and we work that out physically. But Lord, we acknowledge that you are good, that you are holy, and that there's none like you. So as we prepare this morning for worship, for a time of ministry, a time of prayer, that the conviction of your Holy Spirit would be strong. And Lord, we thank you for the scripture in Isaiah 55 that says your word will not return to you void, but will fulfill the purpose for which it was sent. So as we begin to pray and sing, that not fall into a deaf ear, but that it stick, and that it bring the fullness, God, of your will in our lives as we bless you, asking it in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Quickly this morning, good morning, and it's good to have you in Quarter Post Calvary Church. And thank you for watching on Facebook if you're with us today. We appreciate that. We have a lot of people that watch on Facebook, and we really do. I'm glad that they join in with us on Facebook. Real quickly this morning, in November and December, we haven't said anything about birthdays. So if you've had a birthday or going to have a birthday, November, December, we're combining them. Would you please stand up this morning and let us sing happy birthday to you? See one? I think Ashley, I'm going to point out, is having a birthday. There's one back over here. Oh, that beautiful baby. Oh, my gosh. Anybody else? November? got some birthdays around here. Let's all sing happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
We want to have our birthdays here, but I'm ready when I, when God calls me, I want to be glad to have birthdays in heaven too someday. Hallelujah. One thing real quickly, we are going to have Fifth Sunday singing on New Year's Eve. That's December 24th. And so for Fifth Sunday singing, New Year's Eve is December 31st. Keep me in line, everybody. Thank you. Anyway, I've got December 24th. We are having service here for Christmas Eve. And then for New Year's Eve, we're going to have Fifth Sunday singing, and we're going to have our potluck. But to all those people that make food, we're going to keep it on a brunch theme for New Year's Eve. So bring something new and different. And Tracy, you made a cinnamon roll cake that would work great. So everybody, keep that in mind.
So out with the new.
And if you have friends or neighbors that they've been like watching on Facebook, or they've been asking you about Corner Post, that's a great time to invite them. Invite them to come and join in on the singing and potluck, and then everybody be friendly, and then they'll feel like we're family around here and wanting to come. Hallelujah. We're going to sing some Christmas songs this morning. If everybody will stand up, we're going to sing Go Tell It on the Mountain. I think this is an easier Christmas song. I think we're going to strum through it. Hallelujah.
Come let us shine forth, and oh, come let
thank you. And I think we're going to stay standing up, and here we go.
While we play this next one, how about you guys go shake hands and meet somebody you don't know? I heard the whole story, how sick it came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his glory, of his precious blood.
Tomorrow may never be mine. Someone
thank you for this body of believers to gather this morning. Please be with Brother Mike as he brings this message. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Charles, you better watch out. I got you in the front row today. So I got a couple of announcements. I'll mention, I don't know if you ever seen the movie. There's a movie on that's about cowboy churches. And I used to watch it last night. It's called Nail 32. You ever seen it? It was kind of interesting. But I'm also kind of noticing that we've had a little bit of a transition lately, and we're more like a cow baby church. We got a new table set out for the next baby for December, the Andersons. We've already had several come through. I'll let the young couples know we have an opening for April and May. So you can keep the cowboy, cow baby theme alive.
Really, we can't wait.
Also, for visitors, there's a wash tote outside the auditorium there with bags, visitor bags. I always forget to mention that. And every now and then you find a freebie. So I'm here to thank for my new vest, but thank you. I was glad to see it out there that it fit. And I had a couple other announcements I was gonna say something about, but that's why I like the slides. It helps a lot. So the message today is, even for me, very random. I know you're worried. Because it is, how do you find a message that ties in, kind of a part of a Christmas theme, to a cowboy theme, and then end times? It all comes together. But as the picture pops up, we're going to be looking at what I grew up with. And there were three great Christmas movies whenever I was a kid. And I realize there's a whole bunch out there now. But it was a staple for us whenever I was small to watch. You can probably guess what they were if you're around my genre. Miracle on 34th Street. It's a Wonderful Life. And The Christmas Story. And now they got movies out there about Christmas that, and even those three weren't super, none of them really aligned with the scripture, but those were the things you kind of grew up with. But the message today is around the Red Ryder BB gun. And so you're going to see that come up, and if you know a couple of the taglines from the Christmas Story movie, one of them was, you'll shoot your eye out. And if there are other, you don't have it?
We didn't get one.
Can't find it? Okay. I might not have got it sent. But it was the sale bill of the Red Ryder BB gun. And for that, what was he, about 8 years old or something, that he just dreamed all night, all day about this Red Ryder. He wore a Red Ryder. And I can't remember when the message came to me, but the Lord told me this would be my message. And I got pieces of it, parts of it, but the Red Ryder BB gun, if you've ever had one, they were like classic, you know, and I'm not sure they would do much but shoot your eye out. They didn't have a whole lot of hook to them. Now, the Caroline 880s, that's a whole different deal. When you pump those things up, you know, and then you learn you can add more than one BB to it and make it like a shotgun. Air up shotgun, you can do those sorts of things. But I'll give you a quick history just because I think it's kind of neat. Northwest Arkansas, Daisy didn't start off selling BB guns in the 1800s. If you ever been to Daisy's Museum before they moved it. I guess it's still somewhere downtown Rogers. Maybe I'm in the new one. But the original Daisy Manufacturing sold windmills. And when you bought a windmill, you got a free BB gun. Well, somewhere along the course of time, people didn't need extra windmills, but they still want BB guns, so they quit making windmills and started doing BB guns. And the Red Rider, do you know where the scripture is in heaven I'm going to use? Or scripture is in heaven? Scripture is the Bible. I guess it started in heaven. See? But where is the Bible passage that describes the Red Rider? It is. Who said that? Revelation chapter 6. Because there is a white rider, a black rider, a red rider, and a pale rider. And I think pale probably describes my complexion whenever the Lord tells me I want you to preach out of Revelation. Because, Lord, I don't understand Revelation. I can see some things. It's fascinating. I read it. I just don't know. I don't know. So when I first got the scripture reference, it was like Red Rider BB gun. I said, Lord, where's that at? He said, Revelation. So I started reading about it. And for the longest time, I was kind of stuck with it. But I wanted to read this passage to you and tell you what the Lord has shown me. So it starts in Revelation chapter 1. It's entitled, The Seven Seals. Even though Revelation 6 only lists six seals, and you have to go to Revelation 8 to get the seventh seal, which is silence in heaven. So the first seal is what you'll start seeing as Scripture records in Revelation chapter 6, verse 1, and it says, I watched as the Lamb opened the first of the seven seals. And you have to go back to the numbers part of how things work, but seven is the number of completion. Makes sense. The Lamb is who is worthy. Jesus, the Paschal Lamb. We've been kind of going through parts of that on Wednesday night. But it says, then I heard one of the four living creatures say in a voice like thunder, come. I looked, and there before me was a white horse. Its rider held a bow, and he was given a crown, and he rode out as a conqueror bent on conquest. When the Lamb opened the second seal, I heard the second living creature say, come. Then another horse came out, a fiery red one. Its rider was given power to take peace from the earth and to make people kill each other. To him was given a large sword. When the Lamb opened the third seal, I heard the third living creature say, come. I looked, and there before me was a black horse. Its rider was holding a pair of scales in his hand. Then I heard what sounded like a voice among the four living creatures saying, 2 pounds of wheat for a day's wages and 6 pounds of barley for a day's wages. And do not damage the oil and the wine. When the Lamb opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth living creature say, come. I looked, and there before me was a pale horse. Its rider was named Death, and Hades was following close behind him. They were given power over a fourth of the earth to kill by the sword, famine and plague, and by the wild animals of the earth. And then it will go on to talk about the fifth seal, the sixth seal, and the Revelation chapter 8, the seventh seal. But I really wanted to kind of talk about the four horses and the timelines and why this passage is in there. What part of it is 100% literal. Right? God makes connections between physical things, mental, and spiritual. And there's a tie. We don't always see it. We can't connect with it. Even as I'm looking at the four creatures, I have all kinds of questions in my mind about the four creatures. Of course, there's a time element of, Lord, when is this going to happen? And what does this look like? You know, the fifth seal actually goes on to say real quick that I saw the altar, under the altar of the souls of those who've been slain of the world, because of the word, rather, of God, the testimony they had maintained. They're with God. And still, says, they called out in loud voice, how long, sovereign Lord, holy and true, until you judge the inhabitants of the earth? Even the people with God that had already gone through this physical life and into eternity still didn't know. And you can look at scripture from Matthew 24 that says that no one knows the day or the hour. Only the Father knows, or even the Son knows the day or the hour. So a lot of times whenever I would read Revelation, my mind would just reel with ideas and just questions and thoughts and how all this fits together. And then it doesn't take very long to where there starts to be a little bit of fear and anxiety and worry and dread. And then that, as I begin to even think more about that, the fear, the anxiousness grows and grows and grows. And Revelation is a scary book. Revelation causes a lot of people to be anxious and fearful. There's even been churches divided based on the opinion of what a 7-year timeline looks like, being pre-tribulation, mid-tribulation, post-tribulation. People have used Revelation to divide the church. And I want to show you what the Father showed me today, this morning, as I was reading through. Before I do that, you know, let's kind of make this fit. Well, how would you describe the white horse to start with? Pure. So if you saw, and it's interesting to me, even the AQHA couldn't agree upon a white horse until like 2017. They had 14 original colors. Then they added two, then they added two more, and they added the last one. The last horse color that I know that AQHA's added was white. Because for the horse people in the room that would know about the lethal white syndrome, lethal white gene, that there's no such thing as an albino horse because it's lethal. Now there are breeds outside of the AQHA that are white, like if I pronounce it right, the Zingers. That breed is white, but a lot of horses that you see that look white weren't born white. So that actually be more like me and my transition, they're going gray. They didn't start off white. They've changed to be white. But as you look at the first horse, and I think that the other part about being the scripture being figurative and literal, I think that it's the timing of it, is you can see time in the past, but I think there's also a future element to it, which is yet to be seen, obviously. But the first horse sounds like Jesus was riding it. He brought in a time of conquest. He came in, he was an overcomer. He was more than a conqueror, Romans 8 says. He was given victory. The time of Jesus Christ coming, his life, his ministry, all the miraculous things he did, even the time of his trial, crucifixion, death, burial, resurrection, and ascension, could be, in my mind, the white horse as I read the first seal. And a lot of times we read Revelation like none of it's happened yet. But I'm more under the opinion that we're probably somewhere in Revelation right now, not knowing when. And as far as if anybody's wondering about pre-trib, post-trib, or mid-trib, I have an opinion on that. Because I could show you passages that would support any of the three different perspectives. It is a matter of 7 years. I think most people agree upon that. But my strategy is I believe in post-tribulation, And the reason I believe in post-trib is because I won't be disappointed. If pre-trib comes early, thank you, Jesus. If mid-trib, whew, okay, we made it out of that a little bit early. If post-trib comes, okay, that's what I was expecting. But it's not really a, you know, I'd like to think pre-trib, and maybe that's how it works. But if I am so set on pre-trib, and I'm wrong, then there's a great falling away Scripture talks about. And could that be people that were pre-trib that thought, okay, we're going to be gone before anything else happens. Anything terrible happens, we're going to be gone. But I read about the fifth seal, and the fifth seal is all the martyrs for Christ, is that he's waiting for those who haven't been martyred yet. And I'm thinking that sounds kind of like a post-trip sort of deal. But either way, it's kind of that viewpoint that, Lord, you know, I don't need to know, I trust you, but I'm kind of looking at it being a post-tribulation that I will have to go through for the people that are living at that time. May have to endure 7 years. Some may get up, maybe it's the 3.5, maybe it's before the whole seven starts, I don't know. But we have to come to that conclusion on our own. I think I need to read the next two seals. Let me pick back up in Revelation 6, 9. When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain because of the word of God and the testimony they had maintained. I think that's a really powerful statement. They called out in a loud voice, "How long, sovereign Lord? Holy and true, until you judge the inhabitants of the earth and avenge their blood, our blood." Then each of them was given a white robe, and they were told to wait a little while longer until the full number of their fellow servants, their brothers and sisters, were killed just as they had been. I watched as he opened the sixth seal. There was a great earthquake. The sun turned black like sackcloth made of goat hair. The whole moon turned blood red, and the stars in the sky fell to the earth as figs drop from a fig tree when shaken by a strong wind. The heavens receded like a scroll being rolled up, and every mountain and island was removed from its place. Then the kings of the earth, the princes and generals, the rich, the mighty, and everyone else, both slave and free, hid in caves and among the rocks of the mountains. They called to the mountains and the rocks, "Fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of their wrath has come. And who can understand it?" I get some small amount of comfort from that last phrase, "Who can understand it?" It's just, there's so much. And people will act like they know. People will act like they see it and tell you something. And I kind of take that with a shake of salt. Okay, maybe so. But I think that God gives us clues and signs and images that won't make sense until after the fact. And you look back on it. So let me come back to the second horse. The second horse was a red horse. And AQHA doesn't recognize red, exactly red. They might call it a red roan, or they might call it a red dun. And a red dun is really not much red at all. But we'd be more likely to call it a sorrel horse. But to see red, 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 like some of the red I see in the clothing today, don't see that exactly, but the red. So you got Jesus coming on the white horse. And there's a time of peace, a time of fulfillment, a time of conquering. The red, you can look back through some of the timelines and see that right after Jesus' life and crucifixion, that it was probably as bad as it's ever been for believers at that time. Whether the Pharisees were killing off those who believed in Jesus, or if it was Nero or the other rulers of the time, it was a bloodbath. That double-digit AD date was what could have been a red horse. It was very, very difficult. All kinds of murder and killing, and several of those under the altar are from that time frame. The third horse was a black horse. hours, some might say. Well, that'd be like the Middle Ages, when there wasn't a lot of advancement, wasn't a lot of technology, sickness and ailments and people dying from lack of knowledge. It was a time of the bubonic plague. It was kind of a dark time. It's called the Dark Ages, the Middle Ages, that you could kind of see, well, that fits, where Jesus comes with the white horse, the red horse comes with a lot of persecution, and there's a time of a black horse, and then the fourth horse, I take it was a palomino, and it says pale horse, had lost color. And, you know, when people are sick, they're sometimes pale. They're not exposed to the sun, they can be pale. When they are scared, pale. And death itself, pale. But you've got the white horse, the red horse, the black horse, and the pale horse. And then there's no more horses mentioned. The next seal is of that order of the earthquake, the stars fall from the sky, and the heavens roll up and the scroll. You know how that kind of fits together. It was the earthquake, the sun turned black, the darkness, and then the stars. So if you go back and look at some history, some people would say this has already occurred. In 1755, there was an earthquake with a 7.7 Richter scale rating that was in a country I'd never heard of. It's called Lebson, L-E-B-S-O-N, or maybe it's Lesbon. It might be L-E-S-B-O-N. Anyway, I hadn't heard of it until I was trying to figure out some details. But it's on a coastline, kind of over on the lower part of Europe, in an area where once this earthquake happened, numerous people died, and it sent a tsunami wave, and it was felt across a big part of the earth. But when I read this part of Revelation, it sounds like it happens everywhere. So I'm looking at, Lord, how much of this is birthing pains, where it's a little bit, and the intensity and the frequency the intensity goes up, and the frequency goes down, it just builds. But some people would say that this is the fifth seal. The sixth seal even has already happened, because the earthquake in 1755 in Lisbon, then it was 25 years later in 1780 that England had a dark day, that even though the sun came up, that it was hidden, and it was totally dark. This is all captured in historical artifacts. So the day of darkness occurs. I don't read anything about it being a red moon, or that the skies rolled up like a scroll, but they're saying that 1755, 1780, and then it was 1833 in the United States, that there's a meteor shower of 50,000 meteors per hour falling onto the United States, that the stars have already fallen. And I come back and I'm reading this again, and I don't agree. I don't agree that these things have happened yet. We try to relate it back to details that we can, okay, well, that was in history, that was in time, just because you didn't know about it, that it didn't happen, and here's the details. But I'm reading this thinking, I really don't see this event where the sun turned black like sackcloth, made it go here, the whole moon turned blood red, and the stars in the sky fell to the earth as figs dropped from a fig tree. The heavens receded like a scroll being rolled up, and every mountain and island was removed from its place. That every, and I'm just reading it literally, every mountain and every island was removed from its place. And I don't see that having happened. So I give this a lot of thought. And Lord, I see the Red Rider, I see the time of persecution, I see this event where it seems like, I mean, it sounds like a lot of what's happening today, this rider was given power to take peace from the earth. I think you can see that. To make people kill each other. To him was transition point, but it seems a lot like this red time, this time of killing each other and the wars, the rumors of war, and almost every day you wake up with new news. Whether it's the earthquake that came through the south central part of the U.S., and I don't even know if that was this morning or last night or something, if it broke 12 o'clock or which day it was, but it's like these things are just constantly reoccurring. And so I'm reading Revelation, and I just go back even after spending some time studying this, saying, Lord, I'm not getting it. And what he told me was amazingly powerful. I want to share with you. I was looking for the wrong thing. I was looking for understanding of the details, the time, the date, of how to do certain things, how to avoid, how to be ready, how to prepare. And I missed the whole picture. And he had me read the passage in John 15:15. So John 15:15, as we kind of connect the two together, is Jesus talking about the vine and the branches. I am the vine, you are the branches. He goes through and he tells us how all is set up. But in 15:15, I'm going to read around it too. It says, I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. So instead of reading Revelation for details of when, how, where, what do? How do I get ready for it? What can I do to prep, to plan, to be ready? How does all that fit? And Lord is saying, no, that's not the reason I give you revelation. I give you revelation so you'll trust me. I just read the part at the end of chapter 6. It says, no one understands it. I'm always concerned about people who think they do or say they do. Oh, you don't understand that? Let me tell you about the four creatures. Here's what it means. And when I hear that, I'm like, okay, I got a little check in my spirit. I don't think anyone can understand it. It's not there for us to understand. It's there for us to trust. And the simple thought that God chooses to give insight, knowledge, he wants to share his plans. And this happens to us all the time. You could ask somebody in the room that you know, that you like, that you're close with. Maybe they're related, maybe they're not. Oh, yeah, I said you liked them. So however that goes, you might, or, you know, however your connection of you are, you know, related to somebody, and they tell you their plans, and I can't see it. Maybe somebody building a new house. And you go out, you look at, you see the site, you see the survey, you might even see the pad, but you can't see it like they see it. But they brought you out so that you'll be able to share in that, in their dream, in their hope, in what it becomes. And I'm thinking about people that have already got their houses built that I saw in the design phase. And then others who, oh, one day I want to have this house. Or maybe it's like me working on a project. I repurpose a lot of stuff. Some people see it as junk. Whenever I get done, they still may see it as junk, but it's useful junk. I worked on a project yesterday. I took a snowplow, 8-foot snowplow that I bought at an auction for $25, and I took a 1/2-inch skid steer plate and welded to it. I bought that for $125, so I got a $150 snowplow, and today I'm thinking about painting it. I'm gonna paint like the second rider. And you know, I can tell somebody like, I don't see it. I can't tell what I'm gonna do with it. But we share our plans with the people that we care about. We share ideas, hopes, ambitions. We share ideas. We don't do that with enemies. We don't do that with servants. We don't do that with people except those that we are in relationship with. And imagine God taking his junk, which would be us, these salvage parts, these pieces and lives and brokenness that we have, we call humanity, and God knows the plan he has for you. And he's sharing this with us. I think a big part of revelation for me is not to understand, it's to acknowledge that the Lord is showing us what's going to happen so that when it happens, we'll know what God great. Thank you for stopping me to share that. You know, this whole thing is it's almost beyond our comprehension, because he's telling us about future events. He's telling us about spiritual things, and then the physical side, and how that ties together. And some people say, oh, well, that's already happened. And whether it's happened or not, the point is God shares with us his plans so we'll trust him. It's a trust thing. It's not an understanding thing. I don't know how many times I used to tell my children, and they could probably, maybe they counted them, hey, Dad, where are we going? And I could say, I could tell you, and you still wouldn't know. Well, what do you, you don't have the comprehension to understand what I'm about to do. I just need you to get in the truck. I need you to trust me. If you go with me, I need you to know that this is going to be, you know, being in fellowship with me. That's the point I need you to know. What we're going to go do, you're not going to be able to fathom it. Or now that they're grown, they might not get the truck. I'm told what we're going to do. So it's one of those things, you know, you got to be careful about what you share with people. And the Lord's the same way. If the Lord said, okay, I'm going to give you a very detailed exercise of exactly what's going to happen for the remainder of time. And I'll be honest with you, I think we would be too scared to live. This is why it's not a good idea when you go and you're having a procedure. You know, even if it's a tooth or a gizzard, I don't know what it is, but you know, there's certain things I don't need to know. I don't need to know what you're gonna, well, I'm gonna make this incision after I knock you out for about 32 hours, and I'm gonna rip you open, and I'm gonna suck it out, I'm gonna lay for this, I'm gonna cut that, and I hope it all goes good. I don't need to know. I just need to, okay, what time do I gotta be there? And when do I eat last? You know, I don't have to, some of these things I don't wanna know. If you knew today what struggles you'd be dealing with, and if you had known that when you were a youth, would you have welcomed today? Oh, you're gonna have this ache, you're gonna have this pain, you're gonna have this procedure, you're gonna have this situation. You'd be like, oh no, you couldn't live. So God doesn't give us these details so that we can micromanage and understand precisely what it's gonna do. He's doing this because he considers us friends, and he's sharing us with us his plan so that we'll trust him. And so I don't get hung up on heaven. There's a lot of details about heaven I don't understand. Like the 12 pearly gates. I don't get that. And yeah, I can count to 12, but I can't understand a gate so big that's made out of a single pearl. I don't understand that. I don't understand a tree of life that's planted on both sides of the river of life. And the river flows between it. I can kind of see the, you know, go to California and you see those great big trees. And you can drive a car through it, but I can't understand streets of transparent gold, translucent gold that's so common it's like pavement there. I understand that. All I understand is that's where God is and that's where I want to be. It's a trust thing. And so I come back to this 15:15 in John that says, I no longer call you servants because a servant does not know his master's business. Revelation is his master's business. It's our master. It's what I'm going to do. Instead, I called you friends. For everything I've learned from my Father, I've made known to you. What if the idea that Jesus doesn't fully understand Revelation? How's that for a crazy thought? He doesn't know the day or the hour. He may know the year, the month, and the week, but he does not know the day or the hour. But what he does know, he shared with us. You know, it'd be handy to know maybe what the mark of the beast is, but if somebody were to tell me about AI and ChatGPT and machine learning and the future of science, quantum physics, and how it goes together, I'm out. I don't understand it. I don't want to understand it. I need to trust who he is. So as I look at this, the thing that does convince me of how accurate his prophecy is that we will struggle. We will be hated because he was hated. We will be challenged. And the things happening in our life is because we are connected with him. You know, read that as I'm seeing this passage. It says, I'll start in 15:13, greater love has no man than he who laid down want you to see. If the world hates you, keep in mind it hated me first. If you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. Here's our tendency, is we want to be people pleasers. You know, maybe you just got done with some holiday time with your family, and you got a little bit of animosity, you know, siblings and families and things, and how they're kind of arguing and fighting. We want everybody to get along. We want peace. We want happiness. We don't want to insult anybody. We don't want to be fighting and argumentative and have all this broken relationship things, because unfortunately a lot of times we're more likely to be people pleasers than God pleasers. And I'm not saying that you should tell everybody what you're thinking, but I am saying that I'm reading this to realize that there's not going to always be peace. It says if you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. That's why the world hates you. So wake up with that refreshing thought in the morning. The world hates you. The world hated Jesus. Jesus was the creator of the world. Its creation hated him. Talk about biting the hand that feeds you, crucifying the God that made you. Just the simple assurance to me that there's still animosity, bitterness, anger, rage, murder, hatred of people. If that should be a prophetic that people realize, and this is, the Lord said that there'd always be this thing, and people will kill you for it. He said it thousands of years before it happened, and it hasn't stopped. So I'm reading that, realizing a couple of things. What other religion, and I'm talking about false religion, gives people that believe in it a course and a detailed plan of what's going to happen in the future? Do you think that if it's the Hindu that are worshiping Brahma cattle, that they're getting any indication of what's going to happen in the future? Or do you think that Buddha is whispering into his believers' ears what he's about to do? I see a couple of truths here that really, I think, support this idea that the Lord isn't trying to tell you what's going to happen so you'll understand. He's telling you so that you'll trust him as it happens. And that trust piece that we have, I mean, just, I don't know how it resonates with you, but it just makes me want to cry almost to think that God confides in me. The maker of the universe calls me friend, chose me, confides in me, tells me his hopes, his plans, his aspirations, his prophecy, and when it's going to, or how it's going to come true. And I don't get all the details, but just to know that he cares about me that much. But the hatred that's still in the world, remember what I told you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you. If they obeyed my teaching, they will obey yours also. They will treat you this way because of my name, for they do not know the one who sent me. If I had not come and spoken to them, they would not be guilty of sin, but now they have no excuse for their sin. Whoever hates me hates my Father as well. If I had not done among them the works no one else did, they would not be guilty of sin. As it is, they have seen, and yet they have hated both me and my Father. But this is to fulfill what is written in their law. They hated me without reason. So just take a moment of reflection and think about the people that either hate you, and that's a strong word, but dislike you. You can see in their eyes. They can't stand to be around you. You may not even know them. Now, if you're sitting there thinking, well, everybody likes me, then I would start back at John 15:15 again and start reading that over and question where you are. But we are hated because they see enough Jesus in us that we're not hated because of what we do or don't do. We're hated because of Jesus and what he did do. And I read that thinking, this is an amazing prophecy. Because there's not a lot of other belief systems out there that tell you, you will be hated, you will be persecuted, you will be killed, you will suffer many things. You know, read that part about this 1526, to wrap up, John 15. When the Advocate comes, when the Holy Spirit comes, the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father. The Spirit of truth goes out from the Father. He will testify about me. And you must also testify that you have been with me from the beginning. Okay, I read that passage and I can see it. I can see the Holy Spirit giving me comfort, giving me insight, giving me passion, giving me a drive, and talking about him. That makes sense to me. I see it in John where he tells them he's going to send the Holy Spirit. Later on in John, he says, don't leave the city for the Holy Spirit comes. And then in Acts 2, when the Holy Spirit does come, you can look back and you can see it, I think, fairly plainly. But put yourself in the disciples' sandals. And they're hearing this, and they're like, we don't even know what the Holy Spirit is. What do you mean when you leave? You're right here. You're the Messiah. You're the King of Kings. Where are you going? They couldn't understand what Jesus was telling them. Jesus didn't tell them so they'd understand him. Jesus told them so they would trust him. And that trust goes up the next level. Beyond trust, it goes to they are called friends. They're no longer, I mean, hear this for the first time as you're a Jew with all of the pretense under Roman tyranny, and Jesus is telling you, no longer do I call you servants. You're my friends, and I'm telling you, everything God's told, the Father has told me. This position that we have is what reminds me, as I think, bringing it back to the Red Ryder BB gun, and all the different BBs you can shoot out of it, and all the things you can do, of the Christmas story, and a whole circle comes back for me is that even when the little boy was told, I want to give you something, but if I do, you will hurt yourself with it. But he got it anyway. And he hurt himself with it. You know, a couple of life lessons you learned from Christmas Story. If you haven't seen it, younger people, you might want to watch it. You'll learn why not to lick a telephone pole when it's cold. And you'll learn not to wear so many clothes you can't get up whenever you're trying to roll back over. So all kinds of life lessons. And you also learn the word fragile. You get all that from one movie. But it doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense as a child until you get to be older. But you want to give your kids good things, but you know that if you gave them what they wanted, they would hurt themselves with it. But yet sometimes you still give it to them, knowing that they didn't hurt themselves, so they'll learn from it. And do you see the piece of trust, of relationship, of love, that God has included us in telling us what is about to happen, what's going to happen in the end times, how it's going to go down? Not that we can see it from here going forward, but that we can see it from where we are looking back. So that if we wake up one day and the mountains and the islands are moving places and the sky rolls up like a scroll, we don't have to be fearful. We don't have to fear that day. The affirmation, the knowledge that God has told us, he has shown us, is a trust element of relationship that we get to walk with him, and that's what gives me solace and peace, not because I understand Revelation. So as the horses are riding, as the phrase come is coming from the living creatures, and we're seeing all of these things happen in our world, to know that God is in control. To know it's going to get worse before it gets better. To know that he has shared his plans with us. I think that's really powerful, amazing, and I rejoice in that knowledge. I want to see your scripture. We understand the words. Your concept, your precepts are beyond our thinking. Lord, we are finite and you are infinite. But Lord, that you are revealing, pulling back the veil, showing us details of how you love, what you think, how it works. And we start getting pieces and parts, and still it's not fully coming together, Lord. But what is 100% in my mind is that you call us friends. That you have chosen us. That you have a plan. Even though we're going through difficulties and hardships today, pain and suffering, mental and emotional challenges, or this doesn't catch you unaware. In fact, it goes back to let us know that we are hated because you were hated and that the world hates us. Lord, help us be led to people who may be changed into God lovers, that we can live our faith, share our beliefs, and expound upon the trust you give us. We thank you, God, for the time of Christmas that we see you coming into existence through the life of a human to a point that you would walk and do everything, God, that we have been tempted and tried with, and you overcome and you pass that, not because we're capable, but because we trust and believe you. You've given us a position of overcomers where you don't remove the heartache. You don't remove the abandonment sometimes and the frustrations and the criticisms, the challenges we deal with in this world, but you've given us victory over those. And we thank you, God, for a time that's coming in eternity. We thank you, Lord, that as we do walk and we get some reprieve from the different demands of this world, that you still give us snapshots of your glory. And Lord, help us to know more about who you are, but ultimately, I thank you, Lord, for the passage says, do not lean on your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. Lord, for that proverb, we thank you, we trust you, and we welcome you, God, in all things as we bless you, asking in the blood of Jesus.